The Indian culture is deeply rooted in the family. Parents share a very strong bond with children and vice versa. Grandparents form a very important part of the family and children are usually very attached to them. Sometimes there is a clash between two generations as the young one wants to follow the Western way of modern life while the older generation wishes to go with the Indian values. Now, if I ask you, usually, what are the attributes of a grandmother? You would probably say, someone filled with unconditional love, kindness, solace, having great life lessons and experiences. One who always provides emotional support. So well, today, we are going to read about a story, or rather say, about a beautiful relationship between a grandmother and a grandson. The story is in the first person mode, enabling the readers to gain first-hand information straight from the author. It makes the entire story appear more convincing and authentic. The story is taken from The Book of Unforgettable Women. The portrait of a lady is part of an autobiography by Khushwant Singh. In this story, the author draws a pen portrait of his grandmother. He beautifully unfolds their relationship and how it undergoes several changes. In other words, the story is a loving tribute from a grandson to his grandmother. The story gives a picture of human relationships. It is a realistic account of how the grandparents give all their time, attention, and love to their grandchildren. But before we begin with our detailed summary, let us just first know about our author and his personal life. So, talking about Khushwant Singh, he was an Indian author, lawyer, diplomat, journalist, and politician. His experience in the 1947 partition of India inspired him to write Train to Pakistan in 1956, which became his most well-known novel. He earned an LLB from King's College, London and was called to the bar at the London Inner Temple. After working as a lawyer in Lahore High Court for 8 years, he joined the Indian Foreign Service upon the independence of India from British Empire in 1947. He was appointed journalist in the All India Radio in 1951 and then moved to the Department of Mass Communications of UNESCO at Paris in 1956. These last two careers encouraged him to pursue a literary career. As a writer, he was best known for his secularism, humor, sarcasm, and an abiding love of poetry. His comparisons of social and behavior characteristics of Westerners and Indians are laced with wit. He served as the editor of several literary and news magazines, as well as two newspapers, through the 1970s and 1980s. Between 1980 to 1986, he served as Member of Parliament in Rajya Sabha, the upper house of the Parliament of India. Khushwant Singh was awarded with the Padma Bhushan in 1974. However, he returned the award in 1984 in protest against Operation Blue Star, in which the Indian Army raided Amritsar. In 2007, he was awarded the Padma Vibhushan, the second highest civilian award in India. The author recalls his grandmother as a very old lady. For the 20 years that the author had known his grandmother, he had found her old and wrinkled. It was hard for him to believe that she had once been young and pretty. The thought of the grandmother being young and pretty was very disgusting to him. She was short, fat, and slightly bent in stature. Her face was crisscross of wrinkles. Her silvery white hair was scattered all over her wrinkled face. The author remembered her hobbling around the house, which means to walk with a limp or to walk with great difficulty. In spotless white clothes, with one hand resting on her waist to balance her bent body, and the other hand busy counting the beads of her rosary. Her lips constantly moved in inaudible prayer. To the author, she could never have been pretty, but she reflected a divine beauty. She was like the winter landscape in the mountains. The author and his grandmother were good friends. His parents left him to stay with her when they shifted to the city. In the village, his grandmother took care of all his needs. She was quite active and agile, which means to be able to move quickly and easily. She used to wake him up in the morning and get him ready for school. She used to then say her morning prayers in a sing-song manner while she bathed and dressed him, in the hope that her grandson would learn them by heart. The author listened to the prayers because he loved her voice, but never bothered to learn them. After having a thick, stale chapati with a little butter and sugar spread on it for breakfast, they used to leave for school. The author's grandmother always accompanied him to the school as it was attached to the temple. The priest taught children the alphabet and the morning prayer. The children sat in two rows in the veranda. They would sing the alphabet or the prayer in a chorus. While the author learned his lessons at school, the grandmother would read scriptures in the adjoining temple. On their way back home, they would feed stale chapatis to the dogs. The turning point came in their relationship when they moved to the city to stay with Khushwant Singh's parents. In the city, the author went to an English school in a bus. The grandmother couldn't accompany him to the school. As there were no dogs in the streets, the grandmother took to feeding the sparrows. As the years rolled by, they saw less of each other. In spite of her immense interest in his studies, she couldn't help him in his lessons as he was learning English, the law of gravity, and various other principles and scientific theories which she couldn't understand, and this made her unhappy. Sometimes she would ask him what the teacher taught him. Grandmother didn't believe in the things taught at the English school and was distressed to learn that there was no teaching about God and the scriptures in the school. Moreover, she was very disturbed at the idea of music lessons being given at the English school. To her, music had lewd associations, which means vulgar and filthy, and she considered music to be unsuitable for gentle folk. The common link of friendship between the author and the grandmother was broken when the author went to the university and was given a room of his own. The grandmother accepted her loneliness and rarely spoke to anyone. All day long, she sat spinning the wheel and reciting her prayers. Only in the afternoon, she relaxed for a while to feed the sparrows. They perched on her shoulders, which means they sat on her shoulders, and some even on her head, but she never shooed them away. It used to be the happiest half hour of the day for her. The author decided to go abroad for higher studies for 5 years. He was sure that his grandmother would be upset at his departure. But she was not even sentimental. She came to the railway station to see him off. She showed no emotion. She was absorbed in praying and counting the beads of her rosary. Silently, she kissed his forehead. The author thought that perhaps it was the last sign of physical contact between them. After 5 years, the author found his grandmother at the station when he returned. She held him in her arms. He found her more religious and more self-contained. He could hear her reciting prayers. Even that day, the happiest moment for her was feeding the sparrows herself. However, something strange happened to her in the evening. For the first time ever, she did not pray. Instead, she collected the women of the neighborhood, got an old drum, and started to sing songs of the homecoming of warriors. They tried to persuade her to stop, to avoid overstraining herself. But she didn't listen. She fell ill the next morning. She was then diagnosed with a mild fever by the doctor. But she insisted that her end was near. She told everyone that she did not want to talk to anyone and would rather spend her last moments praying. She ignored everyone's protests and started counting the beads in her rosary while praying. After a short while, the author notices that the grandmother's lips stopped moving and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. She died a peaceful death. She was covered with a red shawl. When the author and others came to take away the grandmother's body, they met a strange sight. To mourn her death, a lot of sparrows had surrounded the grandmother's body. They were all silent. When the author's mother offered the sparrows some bread, they refused to eat and quietly flew away after the grandmother's body was carried away for the last rites. Let us now quickly deep dive into the theme of our chapter. So, the first theme talks about family and filial bonds. People brought up at different time sometimes tend to be guarded towards modernization as it changes the world that was so familiar to them. They also feel protective towards their loved ones, which makes them disapproving and skeptical when the younger generation embraces the modernized ways. Westernization and its influences, which are very much common habits in the cities, are at times not acceptable to the older generations, as was the case with the author's grandmother. Nevertheless, the strength of the love for family remains unshaken despite a multitude of differences between generations. That precisely is the strength of Indian families, and thus it forms the core theme of this chapter. The second theme talks about spirituality and the supernatural. In addition to that, her faith allowed her to predict her death and allowed her to pass on peacefully in her sleep. Her ability to predetermine her own death adds a supernatural element to the story. So, in this chapter, we understood the different approaches to life and different aspects of Indian spirituality in cities and villages. It also limelights the objective of evaluating the importance of traditional values. It also talks about appreciating the importance of parental love and family bonding. So see you in our next session. Till then, stay home, stay safe.